As the Buddha said, there are two kinds of causes of suffering. They're the ones that go away if you simply look at them with equanimity. And there are others that won't go away unless you, as he says, exert a fabrication against them. In other words, you have to put in effort to figure them out. And really actively uproot them. And the reason why there are two causes of suffering is because there are two kinds of defilements. They're the ones that cause trouble simply because you don't admit that they're there. And the others that are brazen, you know they're there. And part of you says, what's the problem? That's the part you've got to dig out, the one that sees things in line with the defilements. Now, a lot of neuroses come from things that we don't admit to ourselves, and because a lot of people come to the practice with neurotic problems, that's why so much of the emphasis is on just allowing things, admitting things, accepting things. And a lot of the sting goes away. But if you start saying that tactic works with everything, the second kind of defilement is going to laugh at you. I was reading a book one time saying that craving is not a problem if you simply admit that it's there. It was a book on the Four Noble Truths, and I translated it for John Sawat, and his comment was, well, that person is teaching people to be stupid. Because the defilements that are brazen, they like that. They're happy to hear that you're not going to attack them there, you're not going to try to dig down. Yet these are the ones that cause the real trouble. There's a passage in the canon where a prince is out walking for exercise one morning, and he comes across a novice. Now the novice apparently had had some dealings with his prince before. And the prince asks him a question. I understand that there are monks who can overcome sensual lust. Is that really true? And the novice says, you know, I'd rather not talk to you. You wouldn't understand the answer. And the prince says, well, I might. And the novice says, okay, and I'll give you the answer, but don't argue. The prince says, okay. And so the novice says, yes, there are monks who can overcome sensual lust. And the prince says, I don't believe that. Walks off. The novice goes and tells the story to the Buddha. And the Buddha says, you fool. That kind of person is not going to understand anything about overcoming sensuality because he's so thoroughly immersed. And he's got all the defenses up. And it wasn't just princes back in that time. I was reading the other day someone saying, why is eros or lust classed as a form of craving? Craving comes when you're dissatisfied, and lust is all about satisfaction. And that's about as deluded as you can get. But it shows that then people have their defenses up. And now that kind of defilement is not going to go away just by watching it. Watching it come, watching it go, and saying that it's all okay. Pretending that there's part of the mind that's not scarred by that, that's not affected by that. That's the kind of defilement that you have to dig into. In the Buddhist term, exerting a fabrication. You have to think about the three kinds of fabrication there are. There's bodily fabrication, verbal, and mental. Bodily fabrication is the breath. That gives you one of your primary tools for digging around. It's learning how to change your breath around a particular issue. When anger comes and there's a catch in the breath, try to calm the breath down. When lust comes, when fear comes, try to keep the breath normal. So you have a place to step back and look at the anger without feeling, or the fear, or the lust, or whatever, without feeling that you have to get pulled in, or you have to follow these defilements before you can be rid of them. You've got another place to go. And then you look at your verbal fabrication, in other words, the directed thought and evaluation that goes around the particular issue. How are you thinking about the issue? How do you frame the issue? What are the questions you ask yourself? What are the little maxims you tell yourself? You know that story about Joseph going back to the empty house, and the story about Joseph in Egypt. He keeps telling himself little maxims, you know, the good slave, a good servant, doesn't abandon his duty. The house is not really empty. Potiphar's wife is waiting there for him. But he keeps finding all sorts of little rhymes and reasons to go back. A lot of our defilements are like that. They'll give you all kinds of justification for why you're feeling that. So you have to learn how to question them. And that takes you to verbal fabrication. What are the perceptions you have around this issue? The perceptions here are the mental images, the labels you apply to things. To make a comparison, perceptions are like words. Directed thought and evaluation are like sentences. What are the basic words? What are the basic images? What is your lizard brain telling you about this? Can you believe these things? In other words, you have to dig around. Use your quality of ardency. This is why when John Lee is discussing establishing a mindfulness, he locates discernment in the quality of ardency. In other words, it's your desire to get past these things, to understand them, that you have to burn into them, he says, to figure out what's going on. Because if you don't ask questions around these things, there's no way discernment is going to come. You look at all the great ajahns, and they're asking questions when they're using discernment. Sometimes a question just poses itself in their mind, and they follow it through. Other times they come across a problem, and they try to figure it out. In John Lee's case, he said it was the question of what kind of knowing is ignorance, and what kind of knowing is real knowledge. Apparently, John Munn had posed that question for him, because he said ignorance is not just not knowing. There's knowing there, but it's ignorant. And so that was the question that John Lee probed around and asked and finally got his answer. With all the different ajahns, there's a question that gets posed, and you have to dig around. The answer is not immediately obvious. So this is why John Mahabhua said when he talks about gaining insight, it's a matter of exploring and digging around. It's not just watching things coming and going and thinking about the unbearable lightness of being or the unbearable lightness of knowing and just being content with that. Those kinds of defilements, the ones that you just watched, those are the ones that basically have a sense of shame. If you see them, they just wither away. There are the other ones, though, that are shameless. And they've co-opted part of you. This is why it requires so much digging, because you're going to be digging out part of what you identify with, some of the values you have, a lot of the things you take for granted. So this is one of the reasons why we have to develop really strong concentration, because we need the strength to dig around. We need the stillness so we can see subtle things happening in the mind that we can see only when you pose questions in a mind that's still. And it's not the case that once you pose the question, the answer immediately comes. You have to think about it and test it and dig a little bit deeper and look at things from different angles. That's what the quality of ardency is all about. That's why ardency goes together with discernment, and why it requires so many different tools and strategies. Because the defilements are clever. You attack them from one side, they'll support themselves from another side. So you have to be able to dig all around. It's like a tree with lots of roots. You cut off the roots on this side, but it turns out it's got roots on the other side, and those will keep the tree going. But if you have a strong sense that these defilements really are causing trouble, even when part of you likes them, that's the part you've got to dig around in to see why you're protecting them. So be prepared to use lots of different tools in the practice, because there are lots of different problems. A solution that works for one problem tonight may not work for a slightly different problem tomorrow, which is why your discernment has to be alert. But as all the jhanas say, if you really keep at it and use your ingenuity, you're bound to come up winning in the end.